watching Nord Tuning. This is a channel about rebuilding and modifying your Alfa engine. I finally got my crank back from balancing, so now we can start by rebuilding the engine. But first, let's look at what they did to balance the crankshaft. My intention was to send out only the crankshaft, have it balanced, and later purchase a lightweight flywheel, assuming that these expensive lightweight flywheels would be perfectly balanced. But the machine shop wasn't having it, and they insisted I send out a complete set. So I took a flywheel I had laying around. This is a flywheel I have modified in the past, just by removing some material from the outside. And because of this, I thought it would need a lot of adjustment to get it in balance. But they only had to drill out these two tiny holes. So now let's look at the crank. They only had to do minor adjustment to get it into spec. This hole was bored a little bit deeper than original. So it seems the original balancing is quite good. The only thing that surprised me was this pulley. There was a lot of adjustment needed to get it in spec. It was off by 8 grams. So I decided to buy a new lightweight pulley. This is the pulley I bought. It's an aluminium pulley. It's almost the third of the weight of an original pulley. There's some degreeing on the outside, and on the back there are some holes where you can mount your trigger wheel. The only thing I'm a little worried about is this surface. This isn't perfect, and I hope it will be good enough to make a good oil seal. First thing to do on the rebuild is to inspect the bearings and prepare them for installation. Here you can see on the bearing, on this edge there, on the right side, there is a burr, so we have to chamfer this edge a little bit. Here on this side there is also a tiny burr. I cleaned and degreased all the bearings, so now it's time to check if there are any burrs and just file it out with a 1000 grit stone or a diamond cutter like I have here. You can even file down the highlights on the stamp on the backside. I haven't done this before, but I saw David Weisart do it in one of his videos. So if he thinks it's a good idea, who am I to challenge that? So now you can be sure there are no burrs anymore that can mess up your oil film. And also I took down the highlights on this stamp, so there is a better heat distribution from the cap to the bearing. Now it's time to inspect the bearing crush of the big end bearings. Just place the big end bearings in a rod. Torque the bearing cap to the specified torque. After you've done this, you have to loosen one end of the bearing cap, and with some feeler gauges you can check if the bearing crush is correct. The specified bearing crush is the same as the main bearings. It is 1/800 of a millimeter to 1/10, and I researched a bit. 2/10 is absolute, the maximum for the bearing crush. Beyond that, the bearing will distort. If you have the measurement equipment, now you can check the bearing clearances. If you don't have this, you can use the plastic gauge when you assemble the pistons. It must be measured at three places to be sure that the bore of the big end is exactly round. Now it's a good idea to get a feel how well the bearings, the big end bearings, are turning on the crankshaft. When all is assembled, you don't have a chance to feel if they are binding or not. You could try plastic gauge at this time, but it's hard to keep the rod from turning on the crank when you torque down the rod caps. So this is a bit difficult, and I will do the plastic gauge after I installed the pistons. Use one or two feeler gauges to support the big end so you don't apply pressure to the bearing. And torque it down. It already starts to turn when the bearing is pressed exactly round in the hole, in the bore, I should say. Now you can check if it rotates freely. Good enough. And again, placing the feeler gauges to make sure there is not pressure on the bearing. Now, if you don't have all this measurement equipment, no worries. We will do a plastic gauge measurement afterwards, and then we can establish what the actual bearing clearances are. But first we have to see what the bearing crush is. This is a very simple measurement. Just torque down all the bolts of the bearing caps and loosen all these bolts. Then you have to feel with a feeler gauge what the gap between the cap, bearing cap, and the block is. This should be, according to the books, 0.08 mm to 0.1 mm. When I measured this, the biggest one was 0.3 mm. So it's three times the maximum amount. And I did some research and I came up that 0.2 is the absolute maximum for this. So I had to change this bearing. It was 0.3, and you just do it by grinding it down with a emery cloth on a flat surface like this. This is emery cloth 400, and just take some material off. That's all, until you get the right bearing crush. The crankshaft's in place. It's all lubed up with assembly lube. I placed the plastic gauge on all the main bearings. Now it's time to place the caps and see what the clearance is. Mm-hmm. quite small. This is okay for a road engine. They were just in spec. And if you're looking for a track day car with lots of power, you better look for a little bit more clearance, about 4 to 5 hundredths. And then the crank will have some room to flex a bit under the heavy load it's gonna have to deal with. Now you can turn the crank and test if it rotates freely and never binds. Remember only to turn the crank when all the bearing caps are torqued down to the specified torque. It's a thick assembly loop, so it turns. If you turn slowly, you can get a good feel. I'm not really happy with the clearances I found. I should have checked this in an earlier stage, so this could be rectified. Now it's much harder. Fortunately, I have two bearing sets laying around, and I shuffle the bearings around and find all the thinnest bearings, fitted them, and I could get close to 400ths of a millimeter clearance on all the bearings. But still, the crankshaft wasn't turning correctly, and I was feeling that it was binding. So what went wrong? I cleaned up all the bearings and the crank and put it together again using some light oil. This oil, it's 50% engine oil and 50% WD-40. So I could turn the crank and get a better feel where it was binding. And when I disassembled the crank, I found that there were scuff marks on this side of the bearing and on that side of the bearings. So what happened? Because of the high bearing crush, and when you install the bearings, I always like to shuffle it a bit so you know for sure that it's nice and square. When you leave this side a little bit high, 1/10 or 2/10, at the final stage, the bearing has to turn. Because of the high bearing crush, it is almost impossible for the bearing to turn in the housing. So it will create a dent in the opposite side. This dent is not a problem, but the bulge it creates on the inside is. This will push your bearing closer to the crankshaft, and there will be no bearing clearance anymore.
You can see the dent the key made in the block, and you can see the bulge on the inside of the bore. Here are the scuff marks on the bearings. Finally, the crank is rotating correctly. Here it's rotating with thin engine oil. Now I will measure the force it takes to rotate the crank. This is the crank assembled with the light engine oil. The initial force is a little bit higher, and once the crank rotates, the force will drop because there is an oil film between the bearing and the crank. Here you can see the force. It goes up to 7 kilograms to start rotating, and then it will drop to 2.5 kilograms to 2 kilograms. And now again for plastic gauge. Check all the clearances. Took a lot of time to get this right, but the clearances are better than the first try.
Now I've assembled the crank with assembly lube. As you can see, it behaves a lot different. There isn't a higher initial force needed to get it rotating. It starts rotating when you apply a pressure or force of 2 kilograms to 2.5 kilograms. Only when you want to turn it faster, you need a lot more force. This is because the assembly loop is very thick. Okay, so far for this episode, I will see you on the next one where we will install the pistons. See you!